On the morning of March 26, 2024, a large container ship called Dali departed from the port of Baltimore, starting its 27-day journey to Sri Lanka, carrying nearly 4,700 containers. A few minutes from leaving the port, it clashed with one of the main supports of the Francis Scott Key Bridge, leading to a catastrophic collapse of the bridge and the tragic loss of 6 lives. So what really happened? How can an impact like this cause destruction of a main bridge? Why did the ship lose power a few minutes after leaving the port? Hi, this is Joseph and you're watching The Young Hero Engineer. And in this video, we're going to dive deeper into the reasons that led to the collapse of the Francis Scott Key Bridge and the shutdown of one of the biggest ports in the US. Danish shipping giant Maersk has hired Dali for a planned trip from Baltimore to Sri Lanka, carrying almost 4,700 containers. It was about 1 o'clock in the morning when the Dali departed from the port of Baltimore. 2 tugboats were helping to steer and maneuver the ship out of the port. After the tugboats have left, the ship speeds up to 8 knots, roughly 9 miles per hour or 15 kilometers an hour, approaching the Francis Scott Key Bridge. Suddenly at 1:24 a.m. the ship loses power, drifting off its main course, getting closer and closer to the bridge's main pier. The ship drops anchor, and at 1:26 the pilot calls for help from nearby tugboats. At 1:27 the ship gains power again. At that time, a Maryland Transportation Authority police officer calls for traffic to be halted on either side of the bridge. After a desperate attempt to stop the ship, there was not enough headway, and at 1:28 the ship hits the pier head-on, leading to a catastrophic collapse of the Francis Scott Key Bridge. Unfortunately, 6 construction workers who were filling the potholes on the bridge did not have enough time to leave the bridge before the collision and lost their lives. And this is what happened. But let's reconstruct the events that led to the collapse of this bridge. First, let's talk about the Francis Key Bridge. Built in 1977, this continuous truss bridge with an arch form is primarily made of steel with a suspended concrete deck, spanning 8,636 feet or 2.6 kilometers across the river, with the longest span being 1,200 feet or 366 meters, with a vertical clearance of 185 feet or 56 meters. The bridge was a major traffic and transportation hub for the US East Coast and the entry point to the port of Baltimore, carrying 11.3 million vehicles a year. The main truss section of the bridge rests on 4 supports on each side of the navigable waterways. The design was commonly used to span large distances due to its lightweight and efficient use of materials. However, this type of bridge was not designed to redistribute loads in the event of damage to one of its main piers. This type of bridge is known as a fracture critical bridge, meaning if one section sustains enough damage, the entire structure will collapse. This is because the bridge is made of rigidly connected truss members. This is evident when Dali collides with the bridge. The weight of the collapsing members of the central span lifted the far end of the truss system, eventually pulling the entire section to the ground. This is not the same for the non-truss section of the bridge. The girders are simply supported by piers, which does not allow for damage to propagate to the other section of the bridge. Of the roughly 615,000 bridges in the US, around 17,000 are fracture critical bridges that are quite similar to the Francis Scott Key Bridge. On the other hand, the 2 main bridge piers that support the truss section were now built to handle crashes with ship containers of the same size as Dali. Dali is a big container ship that weighed 95,000 tons when empty, and it is 984 feet or 300 meters in length that would reach the top of the Eiffel Tower if it stood upright. The ship has a capacity of 10,020 foot equivalent units, or TEU for short. At the time of the accident, the ship had nearly 4,700 containers. Although it is not the largest ship in the world, it is still more than what the bridge can actually take. In fact, container ships back in the construction of the Francis Scott Key Bridge were not as big as the Dali ship. Container ship back in the construction of the bridge can only hold 2,000 to 3,020 foot equivalent units. This is significantly smaller than the capacity of the Dali. A ship of that mass and size requires a lot of power to come to a stop. The Dali was moving at about 8 knots or just over 9 miles per hour. Given the size and momentum of the ship, it can take up to a mile to come to a complete stop. This may have been 150,000 tons in motion, the equivalent of 15,000 buses traveling at around 9 miles per hour. During the design of the Francis Key Bridge, the probability of a supersized container ship like Dali hitting one of the bridge's main supports was nearly zero. Engineers do not design structures such as bridges to withstand impact to more than what the bridge actually needs. A ship with a weight of 150,000 tons hitting the bridge pier was never considered in the design of the bridge. However, incidents of bridge collapses like this have happened in the past. The Sunshine Skyway Bridge in Tampa Bay, Florida, collapsed in May 1980 after a 609-foot freighter rammed into one of the bridge's supports, killing 35 people. The bridge lacked a protection system from such collisions. Because of this incident, the Federal Highway Administration issued new standards requiring bridges being built to have an adequate protection system to protect them from such collisions. The new Sunshine Skyway Bridge has a 36 cylindrical concrete dolphins along with two rock islands that surround the main supports. Fenders are structures that wrap around the support columns to protect them from damage, much more like fenders in a car. Dolphins are independent structures typically made of concrete that are designed to stop ships from colliding with the supports, or at least reduce the impact. Unfortunately, the key bridge lacks a robust protection system. The bridge dolphins are placed well in front of the piers, leaving an ample room for ships to maneuver around them. The key bridge dolphins can probably stop a small boat, but not a container ship like Dali. This means that the current bridge protection system is outdated, and Maryland has not updated the bridge to keep up with the current size and weight of container ships. The preferred method for building bridges these days is to allow for redundancy. The Key Bridge did not have any redundancy. In my city, Melbourne, Australia, the Westgate Bridge has a main span length of 1,102 feet or 336 meters. One of its main piers has an artificial island that wraps around the pier to protect it from large container ships. This type of redundancy protects the bridge from such collisions. The cost of repairing such protection system is far less than critical damage to one of its structural elements. A bridge such as the Francis Scott Key Bridge has a very small window for ships to pass through, which would require tugboats to guide the ship out of the port. Tugs can maneuver and escort vessels in dangerous and coastal waterways. The escort tugs is required to assist with the steering and stopping of large ships. If the tugboat had stuck with the ship longer escorting through the bridge, it would have been able to keep the ship in line and prevent it from drifting. Unfortunately, such extended tug escorts aren't required or mandated in Baltimore Port and many other US ports, mostly because of the cost they add to shipping. Each individual port makes its own tugboat rules, resulting in a patchwork across the nation. And because of the competition between ports for business, it has lowered the cost for extended tugboat escorts, which can add tons of thousands of dollars for every transit. Baltimore ports operated by the states of Maryland usually uses tugboats to help maneuver ships out of the docks and doesn't require extended tugboat escorts into the port unless ordered by local harbor pilots or US Coast Guards over safety concern tied to weather, traffic, cargo or mechanical issues. The supply of tugboats is also limited. Tugs are a big upfront cost for shippers and a lot of companies do not want to pay for it. And if Baltimore starts mandating the use of longer tugboat escorts, we will probably see a reduction in their business, as ships will go to other ports wherever is cheapest. Ship pilots in an ideal world would like to have extra tugs with them at all time, until the ship gets to the ocean. But shipping companies don't want to pay for those tugs. However, with the increasing size of cargo ships and the threat they pose on bridges and other critical infrastructure, maybe they should be mandated for long escorts across the US. In the end, there is still so much we don't know. The mystery of the power outage of the ship is still under investigation. Allegations from the city of Baltimore has claimed that the owner and operators of the container ship Dali were aware the vessel was unseaworthy before it left port. According to court documents filled by the city, that Dali has experienced power supply problems hours before departure, which was not adequately addressed, and this will likely take a while before we know what actually happened. Incidents like this are always tragic, but the lesson learned from them will help make future bridges better and stronger, and improve safety protocols for ships entering and exiting ports. Maintaining or adding bridge protection systems such as fenders or dolphins is relatively a cheap endeavor compared to the construction of a newer bridge. It is too early to say how long it will take to open the port of Baltimore or replace the destroyed bridge. However, it probably won't take any less than 2 years to replace the bridge. Thanks for watching. If you're here for the first time, I make videos about bridges. You can check those videos here. Also consider subscribing for future videos. See you in the next one. Cheers.